Good morning. So before I get started here, I was actually kind of thinking as I prepared this talk, I wanted to say something, which is that something about tooling. So I was thinking back, like I've been analyzing data in Python since about 2006, 2007. Can't really remember. But that was kind of pre-pandas days where it was all just raw matplotlib and numpy. And I was just thinking about how far tools have come and like just how inconceivable it would be that I could put together an analysis like what I'm about to show you in that time frame. And really even in the past couple years, there are things that I'm using here which just make my life so much easier. And so I just wanted to kind of say, if there's anyone out there in the audience who works on tools and puts their time into that, thank you. Your work really compounds and makes it possible to do this work and have the jobs that we have. So thank you. This talk is in the general area of business analysis. And specifically, it's about what happens when we stop thinking about business results as being kind of this flow of dollars and start thinking about it as being a flow of dollars that are attached to customers and really analyzing from that customer perspective. And mostly it's about some non-intuitive things about data analysis that happen when you try and do things in that way. So we'll start by kind of framing the question and then we'll look a little bit at some metrics to get some intuition and then we'll dive into models and then look at some results in the framework of that model. So this is kind of what we'll talk through. Maybe to frame it in the framework of this hilariously bad infographic from Harvard Business Review that is being torn apart by the community right now, we're going to start with financial analysis, which is not useful and halfway between time-consuming and not time-consuming to acquire. And then we'll move on to statistics, which is squarely in not useful and time-consuming. Pretty bad graphic. So to start with, this is mostly just like a little bit of the domain that we're working in so that we know that we're right asking the right questions and answering the right questions. And it really starts with asking like what happens when you set the unit of analysis to be a customer. And you start thinking about all the cash flows that are associated with those customers. So like when they purchase with you, you see that cash incoming. You're spending money to build or buy the things that you're selling them, so that's referred to as cost of goods sold in accounting. More holistically than that, you probably have some other costs which are associated with serving that customer. This might be warehouses, this might be salespeople, whatever it be, those are generally referred to as variable costs. And then you probably spend something upfront to market and acquire new customers. And so that's customer acquisition cost, which isn't pointed at a specific customer, but is kind of like apportioned across all customers and then accounted to that customer. So you can kind of think about that in this diagram. So here we've got just money coming into the business is above the y-axis, and then money leaving the business is below the y-axis. And this is the way I think about it, but I'm not crazy about this plot because you can't really see much. Maybe another way to plot it would be as a waterfall. So here we've just got the y-axis being cumulative spending to date, and we see it ticking up as money comes in and ticking down as money goes out. And so I kind of want to define the term customer lifetime value in that way of thinking about things. To do that, we're going to have to add something to that plot and remove something from that plot. The thing we're going to add is this concept of net present value, which is a framework that's really common in corporate finance that we don't have too much time to talk about. But in a nutshell, we're going to take all these costs over time and refocus them for analysis today. And we're going to do that by doing something which kind of adjusts for uncertainty and risk and opportunity cost in those cash flows. And so this is just shown here as being these cash flow is getting smaller and smaller over time. That's not actually the cash getting smaller and smaller over time. That's this adjustment, this discounting taken into effect. This is just a really common way to take a bunch of cash flows and summarize them into one number. And so in that framework, customer lifetime value is typically defined as revenue minus all those variable costs, including the cost of goods sold, and discounted at a company-specific discount rate. I mean, it doesn't typically include customer acquisition costs. You may find, if you work in this, that people may not be consistent about how they define customer lifetime value. When I was reading up on this, I found that CAC was sometimes included and sometimes not. And maybe at the end of the day, what matters is maybe not that we all use the same terms, but at least that we define the terms. And so just a request that anytime you talk about metrics, please just talk about what you're, please just define what you're talking about. The reason there is about internal consistency, meaning that anytime we're going to do some analysis and that's going to add up to some conclusion, we want to make sure that we're accounting for all the components in one and only one place. So if we're looking at margin, we want to make sure that every component of margin is accounted for in one and only one place. And if so, we'll maintain internal consistency. And defining your metrics really helps with that. So coming back to this plot, why do we care about it? I mean, I think we care about it because so much of business analysis revolves around this mindset and revolves around sort of acquiring customers where we expect them to end up above the y-axis, hopefully way above the y-axis, and also operating our business so we're keeping them there over time. So that was kind of the framework that we're going to work in. I wanted to start next by exploring a little data. To talk about the data, I have to talk about where it comes from. So I work at a company called Second Measure. I head the data team there. And what we do at Second Measure is we analyze billions of credit card transactions to answer real-time questions about consumer behavior. So here's some examples of some analysis that we've done in the past. So the first one is looking at retention in the meal kit industry. The second one is looking at sort of regional variation in food delivery, and specifically in this company called Waiter. And the third one was analyzing the impact of Delete Uber on market share at Lyft and Uber. So we deliver this in the form of a self-service analytics platform to our clients. And for hopefully obvious reasons, because we're analyzing credit card transaction data, we're going to simply look at lifetime spend and ignore the cost side of the equation. And so this is not the whole story, but it's definitely a big part of the story. So I'm going to try that thing where I define my metric. So we're going to be looking at lifetime spend, which is gross cumulative sales, and we're not going to be using a discount rate in any of the stuff that follows, and we're also not going to net out any of these costs. I wanted to try and look at this for a company, so I picked Dollar General. Dollar General is kind of a variety store. They had a strategy of building stores in rural America where places like Walmart wouldn't go. And fun fact, they also owned DG.com after winning it in a bidding war against Dolce & Gabbana. So when we want to analyze lifetime sales for Dollar General, we kind of start with raw data. This is what raw data looks like. We've got time on the x-axis, and every dot here just being a purchase, and then each row being an individual customer. To calculate lifetime spend, what we're going to do is we're going to take all those customers and align them by the date of their first purchase, and then we're going to calculate cumulative spending over time, and we're going to average across everybody. When we do that for Dollar General, we get this plot. As you can see, on day zero, they spend $20, and then over the course of about 3 years, it climbs up to $200. And when I started looking at this data and making these plots, I didn't have really great instincts about how they were going to look. And so I looked at this, and I was kind of like, I guess so. But I didn't really appreciate how extraordinary it is that you would get a plot that actually looks this straight, which kind of hints at why Dollar General is kind of a special company. They're exceptionally sticky. So to sort of triangulate that, let's look at some other companies. So we've got Stitch Fix on the top left. Stitch Fix is an online subscription service for clothing. As you can see, lifetime spend is quite a bit higher for Stitch Fix than it is for Dollar General. But you also see this very typical curve in that lifetime spend data, and that is essentially customer churn. So when Stitch Fix starts out, they have a large number of active customers, and then over time, people get tired of the product and cancel. And so that's why you see this sort of curving behavior there. Another example being Wayfair. So Wayfair is a online furniture retailer. And the interesting thing about Wayfair is just that their lifetime spend is very front-loaded. So people spend an average of $200 on their first day, and then you can see spend climbing up over time from there, which is actually kind of a problem for Wayfair. So this is lifetime spend. This is kind of what we want to reason about. And so the question is, why are we not done with this talk? What's unsatisfying about this picture? And the answer comes with something that I failed to mention when I defined my metric, which is that to do this, we have to align all those customers, and then we're forced to ignore people who haven't had the entire lifetime of that plot available to us. And so we're actually excluding customers where we have less than 3 years of history on them. And so that's really unsatisfying. Coming back to this diagram, you know, I'm a data scientist. I think of it as my job to empower decisions. And the truth is that you very rarely have to make decisions on a plot that looks like this. Realistically, you're often making decisions based on a plot that looks like this. You've got very little data on people. And then if you're working in marketing, your situation is even worse. You're reasoning about people with no data on them. So you're thinking about hypothetical customer acquisition cost and trying to balance it against hypothetical lifetime value. So that's the essence of the hard part of customer lifetime value, is dealing with incomplete data. And to deal with that, we're going to bring in some models. So the game plan is going to be fairly simple. So revisiting this raw data plot, we're going to build models that are based on the past data here. And we're going to use those models to impute data past today, past that black line. And so everything to the right of that line is sort of going to be filled in with expectation values. And then we essentially analyze the combo of the real data and the expected future data together as if they were the same. Customer purchase behavior is fairly multifaceted data. You've got these counts, you've got churn behavior, you've got transaction amounts, you've got dates. And so to deal with this, we're actually going to have to sort of factor the problem into subproblems. And we're going to start by focusing almost entirely on modeling transaction counts. I like to start these kind of scenarios by asking, what is the simplest thing that might work? And when you're talking about sort of modeling counts of events in time, the simplest assumption that you might make is a Poisson process. This is kind of just your classic first order assumption of a memoryless process that goes on over time. And it turns out that if you fit these to data and analyze how well they fit, they don't fit very well. And the answer is in this pictogram. Anybody kind of want to guess? Anybody? The answer is Poissons don't churn. See, it's a French fish, sorry. churn is simply a fact of life in business, is that people will be very engaged with your business, and then at a certain point, they'll just drop out, and it's because they either went to a competitor, or they left the space, or they just aren't interested in you anymore. And so we really need to kind of expand our model to account for churn. So let's ask, what's the next simplest thing that might work? What we're going to do is make the assumption of some processes that are happening but are unobserved, they're latent, all adding up to the data that we see. The assumption that people commonly make is that you've got a Poisson process at the top, which is essentially going on till infinity, but that is filtered through a birth-death process where any purchases, hypothetical purchases that happen after the death date are going to be truncated in our observed data. And the name of birth-death process here is kind of taken from survival analysis, and it's just a code name for these kind of assumptions where you assume that something's going to happen once, and then after that thing happens, you're at hazard of something else happening, but that second thing can only happen once, aka your death. And survival analysis is kind of, if we were in that middle scenario and that was our data, we would be modeling time to event data and would be naturally using survival analysis. So you can write down the likelihood that's kind of implied by that probabilistic model, and you can infer back to, we're going to infer back to two parameters. And so the parameters that we get out of this model are the rate parameter of this Poisson distribution. It's essentially the expected number of purchases per unit time, conditional on not churning. And then we're going to have a second number, which is our probability per unit time of churning, which is called a hazard rate. And so you add those two parameters together, and you get this little graph that's in the middle. And this is essentially our prediction that this person is still in your customer base over time, conditional on the data that we've seen down on the bottom. So we know that this person is alive until their last purchase. And then after that, we're sort of weighing the possibility that they churned, or the possibility that the Poisson process is just taking a break, a natural stochastic break. So this kind of hints at the framework that we take here. So we're going to jointly estimate transaction count and churn, and then separately we're going to deal with all the other components of customer lifetime value. So when I first saw this framework, I was a little skeptical that it was really necessary. It seems a little complex to have to do these two things jointly, and so I wanted to ask again: is this really the simplest thing that might work? To do that, I'm going to sort of look at some toy data and illustrate something that might be ideally simpler. So this is a hypothetical purchase history for a customer, and so this customer transacted 6 times over 3 days. And so we can just compute their empirical rate of transactions per time. In this case, we would see 2. And the question is, do we think that this is an accurate estimate of their future purchase rate? And the answer is no. I've kind of set up this problem to be intentionally a bad idea. The reason being is that we're ignoring all the negative space. So there were three other days where the customer didn't purchase at all, and we haven't included those in our mean. And so that's why we would be overestimating their purchase rate. This might sound like, you know, a fairly dumb idea, but pretty much any time I go to do analysis, I make mistakes like this. So just wanted to spell it out here. So we could compute our mean again, including these zeros, and get a different number. And the question is, do we think that this is an accurate estimate of the go-forward purchase rate? And the answer is a little more subtle, but it turns out that this is also an overestimate. And the reason is because there's more negative space that we've actually ignored in our estimate there. So the sixth might not actually be the day that the customer had churned. There might be simply more days where they didn't purchase just because of randomness and not because that is their actual like churn date in the framework of this model. And so we've actually underestimated by not including that little negative space at the end. And the tricky part is that the amount of that negative space is unknown to us and is going to depend on that customer's purchase rate. And so this kind of hints at why purchase rate and churn are somehow entangled in a way where we have to model them jointly as opposed to modeling them separately. So I did a little simulation analysis to kind of quantify this, an analysis where I knew the true rate so that I could quantify how bad this bias is. And it turns out it's not too bad if you're willing to bucket your data. So if we just roll up our data to months or quarters, we're going to get to a point where we have a fairly large expectation of events per unit time. And if you're willing to bucket to the point where you maybe have like 1 or 2 expected events per unit time, then you might be OK. You might be in the 6 to 2% bias range. But you know, that is actually a deal breaker for most realistic companies. So I looked across our data. We analyzed thousands of companies at second measure. And this means that you're bucketing at quarters or years or worse. And so you're having to make these very coarse-grained estimates if you use this somewhat naive analysis. So yeah, that's kind of the first big idea in these models, is to make this hybrid probabilistic model, but kind of compose it from fairly familiar building blocks from Poisson estimation and survival analysis. And These models are generally referred to as counting your customers models, which is named after the first paper where this idea was kind of formed. That's the first big idea. The second big idea that I want to talk about is something you'll come across in a lot of these papers, which is customer heterogeneity. So to motivate that, I want to look at these rates for these customers. So we're just going to take a data set where each row is one customer, and then we're going to calculate the number of purchases divided by the number of days, so divided by the time that we observe that person for, and we're going to plot it. This is what it looks like for Dollar General. So each tick here is a customer. And the first thing that jumps out to me here is that variability is extreme. So I've had to plot this on a logarithmic axis, and the bulk of the data lies in three full orders of magnitude. So this is just kind of a universal fact about companies, is that the range of activity of your customers is going to be extremely, extremely wide, and you have to deal with that. Another way of seeing that is to go back to this plot. So, you know, if you're like me, you made this plot, and then you sort of thought about customers in kind of orderly fashion marching up this plot. But if we bring back the raw data and plot that on the same plot with the average, you see that it's much more chaotic than that. So we have a lot of customers who appear very close to the x-axis and basically never purchase with Dollar General, and it's being counterbalanced by a small number of high-value customers. And so this is also just a realistic fact that you have to deal with. The second thing that jumps out into me in this plot is these striations over on the right-hand side. I don't know if you can see that up there. But these look kind of alien to me. It's odd that our data was so organically perfect and Gaussian, and then we have these little ticks over there. Like, what are these? Are these Elon Musk? It's very high rate. I don't know what it is. And the explanation for that is actually a lot simpler and pretty easy to see if we revisit the calculation we're doing and we split by that denominator in the calculation. So we've got the people who we saw for a very long time up on the top, and then down at the bottom we saw people who we saw for a fairly short period, and we can probably guess that the estimates that we had for them are just pure noise. So these models have a way of dealing with this that is kind of motivated by multi-level models. If you were here yesterday for Xiaorob's talk on random effects models or mixed effects models, it's a very similar idea. Mixed effect models are kind of a class of multi-level models. Multi-level models are also known as hierarchical models, just in case you don't need more terminology. So I kind of want to motivate them in this framework of estimating customer purchase rates. So the big idea in multi-level models is that we can set up an explicit probabilistic model that goes from customers to events so that we have some idea of the noise which appears in this data. And then we're going to rein in these very sparsely observed customers essentially with a prior in a Bayesian sense. So we will regularize these counts to be something more in line with what we've seen. And the novelty is that you fit the prior is motivated by data, and so you jointly fit the prior itself and the customer level estimates. And that has the effect of basically choosing a prior which is going to be based on this uncorrupted data up on the top. So I think that's a really powerful general idea. It's a way to sort of fit really richly parameterized models. In this case, we're fitting two parameters per customer, but still do sensible things when we have very little data. With that, I wanted to mention this very cool library called Lifetimes. Lifetimes is a library for fitting models like this from data. It was open sourced by Shopify and written by Cameron Davidson Pilon, who's a data scientist at Shopify. And it's a very easy to use kind of sklearn style way to fit these counting your customers models. There's a variety of them. I'm not going to go into it too much, but this idea kind of came around in 1987, and then it's been improved over time. So if I can just be opinionated, I think you should use the last one. It's called the modified beta geometric negative binomial distribution. And that's named from the assumptions that you're taking on these probabilistic processes. And these, that's also what Shopify uses in their own work. To sort of show some example analysis, I wanted to pick a different company, and I wanted to pick something with a little more local flavor than Dollar General. So we're going to look at Bird, the scooter startup, in case you don't know. So we can make this chart. This is lifetime spend for Bird, but it's really unsatisfying. So first of all, we only have 180 days worth of data that we can plot over. And in doing so, in picking 180 days, I've had to throw out 90% of Bird's customers, because Bird is a hockey stick. We can kind of band-aid that a little bit by cohorting. So in this plot, we're doing the same calculation, but we're grouping every customer by the date of the date of their first purchase, and then plotting each one separately. And this plot actually kind of cleanly gets at that kind of missing data problem, which is that our history ends today. It ends at the end of the x-axis. And we're going to have to do a variable amount of imputation on each of these different cohorts. So our game plan is going to be to simply fit one of those models and use it to estimate that complete estimate of lifetime sales. I actually did something a little beyond that, which is break it out by geography. So Bird is growing in different regions in the US. This is sort of a plot of new customers by month for the three regions where they're operating in. And the top one is red, in red is the West. And then as you can see, the South has been catching up, but sort of caught on later and has been growing later. So if we were to try and do sort of an analysis of customer spend based and compare the South against the West, we would run afoul of the problem that there's a very different mix of customer vintages. So the South customers are on average newer, and so we have less data and can't really sort of naively compare them. Again, we can make this plot, and you can see from the plot that the South has a lower average lifetime spend than the West, but we can't really make a conclusion from this plot in a very easy way. So to do this, I fit one of these counting your customers models, and I fit one model for the West and one model for the South, and then used it to project out 24-month sales for a randomly selected person in the population for these two regions. And then we're going to try to do that thing on the left where we define our metrics. So we computed 24 months expected total sales, didn't use a discount rate, and as you can see, the conclusion here is that the South has a 16% lower lifetime spend than the West does. And this is just to sort of drive home that in general, the concept of customer heterogeneity means that we can't treat all of our customers the same. We can't expect them all to behave the same. And if you're Bird, we're going to have to think about how to deal with estimating markets where we don't have much data yet, because we can't really assume that they're the same as our other markets. So just to wrap up, I know we're going late. I wanted to go over the core ideas that I spoke about. So the first one is this workflow where you build models from past data, you use those to project the data that you wish you had, the near future, and then you analyze the combo of them, and I found that to be a fairly generic and powerful workflow. The second idea is that probabilistic models can be composed of familiar building blocks, and you can fit them to tailored situations like this customer purchase behavior. The third is to mine the noise, mine the variability in your data set. And the fourth is that customers, by their nature, will be extremely variable. And the fifth is, if you ever have to use a metric, just please define it. So here are some references if you're interested in learning more. So we kind of glossed over corporate finance, but I'm a huge fan of Aswath Thamodaran's lectures. He's a professor at NYU Stern and puts all his courses online. If you're interested more in multi-level modeling, this is a great book by McElraith. For the counting your customers models we talked about, read up on lifetimes, and also the blog post that Shopify put out. And then lastly, we hinted on survival analysis, and I just want to plug a talk that some of my former coworkers gave that is really good about motivating why you would use it. With that said, I work at Second Measure. A lot of our work is on our blog, so please visit our blog and read up on it. And as you can guess, we're hiring. I'd love to talk to you. And I hope that this talk has given you, sparked some ideas in your own work that you can take. Thank you.
All right, very nice, good talk. Does anybody have any questions? We've got a few minutes for questions. We're about 10 minutes early, actually.
So when you're identifying the customers, are you identifying them based on credit card number, or a hash of a credit card number, a hash of a name and a credit card number, or how are they identified? Because when I walk into with cash, Dollar General doesn't have my info.
Right, that's true, yeah. That is a caveat with the data that we analyze, is that it's credit card info, and then we generally just sort of, we analyze anonymized data, but we have an ID which refers to that person and that person across their accounts.
Hi, thank you very much. That was a really awesome talk. I tend to use Lifelines as an alternative library. Do you have any thoughts on that? And one other question, I'm sorry to back into because I do a lot of this work, is how do you handle what I call frothy churn, which is where a user comes in, leaves, comes in, stays. This is a subscription model where they stay for a couple months, then leaves. And it's like they literally bounce back and forth between these two sort of states.
Yep. Yeah, sure. Your first question, it is confusing. So Kimmer and Davidson Kalan has open sourced two packages. They're called Lifelines and Lifetimes. And Lifelines is for survival analysis, which is when you're analyzing time to event data. And Lifetimes is for customer lifetime value estimation, which is where you have individual purchase events and you're trying to summarize them into customer lifetime value. Oh, I don't have it here. But so depending on whether you have a subscription or a non-subscription business, you might make the choice of going one way or the other. In the literature, they refer to this as contractual and non-contractual. And what we're talking about here is really the non-contractual case where you can make a purchase at any given time. If you're in the contractual setting, you might be analyzing this differently. And if you want to sort of have that model where people can in effect churn and then unchurn or resurrect, you might be looking at something like a hidden Markov model or something like that. So I don't have a ton of experience with that. And then in the non-contractual setting that I'm talking about here, it's very common to sort of assume only one churn event.
Other questions?
Hi, thanks for the talk. This was great. I follow Second Measure's blog actually quite a bit. I do work in subscription models and
awesome
as well. Question for you though, around your data, the raw data, how well do you understand like the bias that's in, like, because my understanding is you have a set of credit card transaction data that's some sample of like all customers, all transactions. And then what kind of analysis, how well do you understand that as far as like this as a sample of the population and what biases might be in there and things like that?
Thanks. Yep, good question. So it's a huge topic and something that we have to be really good at. I didn't really talk about it here, but that kind of hints at why I mentioned social scientists here is that you know, there is a field that doesn't start with the assumption that your data is representative in IID, and we have to worry about that a lot. And so basically it's just sort of like understanding and modeling out, quantifying what we think the representativeness might be with respect to some other reference data, and then attempting to adjust for that using social science methods.
Other questions?
Up front, maybe?
Front, okay.
What have you found to be the performance limitations of Lifetime?
Good question, yeah. So these models jump through a fair amount of hoops to attain scalability, the main strategy they take is that we don't need to feed it a data frame where each row is a purchase. We kind of summarize to a customer, and then for that customer, we calculate these three sufficient statistics, and then you fit the model using maximum likelihood. So I don't have hard numbers on where the model kind of breaks or where it fails to scale, but in a rough ballpark, I can fit models on my laptop with 100,000 customers, which is like a fairly large company, in a couple seconds. And I get the sense that sort of if you go a couple order of magnitudes beyond that, you're going to be talking about problems. And I know that Shopify also wrote up a little bit on how they deal with scalability, and they have a pretty big data problem. So you could read their blog.
We have time for two more questions. Any more questions? All right. Thank you. Let's give Brian another hand for a great talk.